This is Radio 2
on BBC Sounds
and on your smart speaker.
Play BBC Radio 2.
Now, this is Phil Williams. Listen live on BBC Sounds.
BBC Radio 2.
And welcome to Wednesday, the 3rd of January.
Now, Midnight Mastermind.
Doesn't bode well, does it? I've got a Midnight Mastermind to do now. Getting things wrong already at 12:31. What's going on, Williams? So far, I've done one of these this week because we weren't on New Year's Eve into New Year's Day. And it was Paul in St John's Chapel asking me the questions on...
Crane flies of the UK.
Crane flies of the UK, a.k.a. Daddy Long Legs. And what we learned last night at school... was that they only live for 24 hours. So if you see a daddy long legs round at yours, feel sorry for it, because it's only got a day to live. Let's see if we can follow that cheery subject then. Morning, Midnight Mastermind contestant, for a Wednesday morning. What's your name and where in the world do we find you?
Good morning. My name is Andrew Morn Hughes, and I am in Holyhead in Anglesey.
Very nice. Well, I say very nice. It's usually very nice, but I would imagine it's swirling around, is it?
It was a bit damp today, shall
to
we say
the least. Yeah. What's your chosen special subject for me, Andrew?
Well, you're in Salford, aren't you?
Yes.
Yes. Well, we'll start this quiz early.
Go on.
Let's see if you can figure out the subject first.
Okay.
The questions this evening will be about three very famous brothers.
Right.
Whose childhood home was only about 3 miles
yes.
away from where you are right now.
I'm going to give you a clue. I think it's to do with... the Bee Gees.
You are absolutely right.
Excellent!
Very good.
Excellent.
Very good. That's
Excellent.
A good start, huh?
Do I get a point for that?
We'll see how you do in the
yeah, whether I need it. All right. I'll do some revision to Peter Gabriel. Sledgehammer to crack a nut. And then we'll answer some questions on the Bee Gees. Be embarrassing if I get these wrong. One of my first jobs in local radio was to go to their school and report on this school in Chorlton, which is right down the road from OJ Borge's house. True story.
Yeah.
Sledgehammer, Peter Gabriel. We're partway through a Midnight Mastermind here on Radio 2 with the lovely Andrew in a stormy Anglesey who's chosen tonight's specialist subject, which is, Andrew?
The Bee Gees.
So why have you chosen this?
I am considered an expert on the subject. I've written a few books about them.
Okay, how many books?
So... well, I'll go through them for you now. the first one was called Tales of the Brothers Gibb, which came out in 2000 initially. Uh-huh. But that's gone to four English editions, plus it was translated into Russian and into German.
Wow.
Then the most recent books that I've written are part of a series called Decades. So the first one was called Decades, the Bee Gees in the 1960s. Mm-hmm. The second one was obviously the 1970s. And these are actually collaborations with a couple of very, very good friends and fellow Bee Geologists.
Oh, I love Grant that, by Walters. The way. I love that, a Bee Geologist.
Well, that was a term bestowed upon me by the Bee Gees' personal manager, Dick Ashby, many, many, many years
wow.
ago. But my co-writers are Grant Walters, who is in the United States, and Mark Crowan, who's in Australia. So sort of you're getting a lot of different kind
wow.
of, you know, cultures and stuff like that being put into the mix here. It works really, really well. Actually, the guys came over in September, and it's the first time we actually got together, sort of the three of us. I've met Grant previously, and I've met Mark previously.
What is the correct collective noun for three Bee Geologists?
Bee Geolii, I suppose.
Excellent. Well, look, let's push on with the quiz and see how I get. I've got a feeling. I mean, this is such a vast subject that I wasn't able to do a ton of revision. So let's see where we go.
Midnight Mastermind.
On the Bee Gees, it's Andrew in Anglesey who's written four books about them. Go ahead.
So, question one for you. Everybody thinks of the Bee Gees as three brothers, mm-hmm. Barry, Robin, and Maurice Gibb.
Mm-hmm.
But in 1967, 1968, mm-hmm. during their first flush of international fame, the group actually consisted of five members. Can you name either of the other two?
I'm going to show off and name them both because it was one of the first photos that I saw in the revision. So I'm going to go for, is it Vince Maloney? I don't know if that's the correct pronunciation. And Colin Peterson?
They are the correct answers, yes. Colin Peterson was the drummer and Vince Maloney was the lead guitarist.
Excellent, we're off the mark.
You are. Vince, actually, both of them were actually Australian musicians, but they came over to the UK and they hooked up with the Bee Gees over here. But Vince is actually back in the UK right now.
Oh, okay.
So he actually lives over here. And he was really, really helpful with the 60s book. He actually wrote the foreword for us, which
nice.
Was really, really good. So, and as well as Spencer, Robin Gibb's son, he's actually writing the forewords for all of the books in this series.
Oh, that's incredible. That's lovely. Okay, question number two.
Question number two. Right, okay. The Bee Gees, they've got a vast catalogue.
Yeah.
And they've recorded 22 studio albums. But it could have been 23. An album that was scheduled to release in mid-1973 remains unreleased to this day. What was that album called?
Oh, did I see this? I saw a couple of 73 albums, but I'm not sure. I don't think I saw one that wasn't released. The one that I was... there was something about getting kicked in the head, but I think that was released.
That's the one.
Oh, it is the one.
That's the one.
A kick in the head is worth two in the bush. No, or it's something else. It was worth eight in the pants or something.
That's the one.
Is that it?
That's it. That's the one. Very good.
Oh, I was between that and Life in a Tin Can.
Yeah, well, sort of those two. Life in a Tin Can was recorded in September of 72, and they stayed in LA, and the next month in October, they recorded A Kick in the Head.
Wow.
Life in a Tin Can was released in March, and A Kick in the Head was scheduled for July, but it just didn't happen. It was rejected by the record company.
Do you think it'll ever come out?
The current climate, probably not. It's right. It's a shame, lots of it, because it's a pretty good album, all told.
Well, I don't know where I dragged that from, but it definitely caught my eye in the revision, and I'm delighted it was the right one. Let's see if we can nail a full house. What's your last question?
You'll never forget that one now, will you?
No.
So, in the 1980s, the Bee Gees took a break from being an active group.
Yeah.
But they continued to release some solo material, and of course, like today, wrote and produced for other artists.
Yeah.
Can you name any of the many artists that they wrote and produced an album for?
I think I can. Just as individuals.
Robin produced an album for somebody, Barry did as well.
Well, I think I'm fairly confident, even before the revision, in saying that didn't Barry work with Barbara Streisand on Guilty, because I really love that album. Does that count?
Yes, that's absolutely right. That was a global number one for them with the album, and similarly with The Single Woman in Love.
Excellent.
But the full list here, you get a ping for that one. Like, if you get a
well, do you know what?
Full
because,
house for that.
Yeah, so because it's a full house, it's not just a ping; it's a ping, Anna.
Hallelujah.
Yeah, hallelujah! It's all round. Go on, you want to do? Do you want to do the others?
The first one was Jimmy Ruffin's album Sunrise, which was produced by Robin. He had a couple of hits from that one with Hold On to My Love and Night of Love. Then, of course, in 1982, Barry did Heartbreaker for Dionne Warwick.
Oh, yeah.
83, he did Kenny Rogers' I See in the Dark album, which spawned the single Islands in the Stream, which was the biggest selling single in the history of RCA Records. Then in 85, of course, there was Dinah Ross with the Eaten Alive album, which had the big UK number one hit, Chain Reaction. Now, those are the ones that most people know, but there's one hidden away in 1986, which was produced by Morris for a young lady called Carola, and the album was called Runaway. Now, people in the UK could know Carola. Her name was Carola Hagqvist, and she's Swedish, and she represented Sweden in the Eurovision Song Contest three times.
Ah.
She won it in 1991 for them. So,
well,
she's not a total unknown, you know.
There is no doubting your supreme knowledge in this topic, and I'm just grateful that I managed to somehow fluke a full house on it and not embarrass myself. I've picked a Bee Gees track.
Well, you got four out of three, didn't you, really?
Yeah, because I got the subject. I've picked a track for you. So the final part of the quiz is, and there's only a 7-second introduction on this, so I'm going to play it, and you're going to shout the title as soon as you know what it is. I reckon you'll get it quite quickly. You ready?
Okay, try me. You Should Be Dancing.
Well done, Andrew. You Should Be Dancing, and we will now together. Have a good and see ya.
You too, Phil. Happy New Year.
See you.
As Andrew said rightly, they went to school about 2 miles to my left. Oh, across the way, past Old Trafford and down into Chorlton. It's the Bee Gees. You should be dancing. If you'd like to come and do a midnight mastermind of your own, email phil@bbc.co.uk with your name and what your chosen specialist subject would be.
This is Radio 2.
On BBC Sounds.
And on your smart speaker. Play BBC Radio 2.